Εκεί Σιδηροπούλου, που είναι an assistant professor of neurophysiology in the biology department. You know, probably most of you know Kiki from the graduate programs. She has taught in quite a few courses, and also through her collaboration with the group of Yota Polinazzi. She's interested in two things that have to do with prefrontal cortical function, and especially age-related changes in prefrontal cortex. And today she's going to talk to us on neurophysiological mechanisms of cognition.
Thank you, Anna. And I'm very happy to be here to present you the work that we do in our lab for the past 3 years. So this is quite a general title, neurophysiological mechanism of cognition, but in general in the lab we're interested in several different processes that can go under the label cognition. And these processes include short-term memory, long-term memory, working memory, attention, behavioral intuition, and adaptation to rule change. In the lab we currently work on these three for the show here. Processes, long memory, working memory, and rule changing. And today I will talk to you about these two. So we have three different modes of working with the cognition. So we study the cellular mechanisms of cognition under physiological conditions. We study the learning induced adaptation. So when an animal performs a task that allows him to learn something, what changes occur in the cellular mechanisms of cognition. And we study how these mechanisms are altered in pathological conditions, such as schizophrenia and aging. And today I will refer to schizophrenia. Also, I won't talk to you about the learning-induced adaptations. It's quite an and quite complicated for now. But I will refer to you on the cellular mechanisms and how this changes under pathological conditions. So right now we are focusing on the GAA, as Lona mentioned, the prefrontal cortex. The prefrontal cortex is the brain area that is situated in the frontal lobe. It is the brain area that has evolved and expanded the largest in humans. However, since we study rodents, rodents do have a prefrontal cortex, and this is known based on specific neuroanatomical projections. As I mentioned, the prefrontal cortex is involved in mediating several higher order cognitive functions, most of them that I mentioned before. A basic cognitive function that is mediated by the prefrontal cortex is working memory. Working memory is a type of short-term memory that allows us to remember something for a few seconds before we use it. For example, remembering the phone number for a little bit until we dial it or write it down. And it can be working memory, mostly. The prefrontal cortex also mediates processes of attention, behavioral inhibition, rule learning, decision making, and it is also known to be involved in long-term memory storage and emotional regulation. Just like every area in the cortex, is composed of six layers: pyramidal neurons, which are the excitatory neurons in the cortex and secrete or release glutamate as their transmitter, are found in layers 2, 3, and layer 5. And there are also several types of interneurons, which are the inhibitory neurons in the cortex, and they release the transmitter GABA. And these interneurons, they come in several shapes and forms. They can be classified in many different categories based on physiology, morphology, anatomy, expression of the different types of proteins. We can classify them into three different categories based on the calcium-binding proteins that they express. And so we can have carbarbumin interneurons, which are they're fast-fighting, and also project to the soma of the pineal neurons. We can have carbinding in the neurons, which are thought or are known to be regular spiking in the physiological behavior, and usually seen up into the dendrites, apical dendrites of pyramidal neurons. And also there is calretin in the neurons, which are thought to be irregular spiking, and seen up into the apical dendrites of pyramidal neurons or other interneurons. So as I mentioned before, the prefrontal cortex can be thought of as an area that is involved in word memory, but also in long-term memory. The correlate of word memory is known to be persistent activity. This was first identified in the 70s by Joaquin Fassler, and has been greatly studied by Goldman Rakish. So how do we find persistent activity? If we have an animal performing a word memory task, which is composed of three phases, the cue, the delay, and the response phase. So in this specific task, a visual cue is presented to the visual field of the monkey, in this case, at this point, but the monkey has to focus on the center of the visual field. After the delay period, where the animal sees a black screen in front of them, and during this delay period, the animal has to remember where this cue was. During the response period, the animal has to make a saccade, so turn his eyes towards the cue, towards the place of the visual field that the cue was. And only then he gets a reward. So if we record neurons from the prefrontal cortex during this task, we find that specific neurons in the prefrontal cortex are active during this delay period when there is no external stimulation. So here you see, for example, firing of the neuron during this cue period when the animal sees the visual stimulation, and persistent firing of the neurons during the delay period. This delay period activity, or persistent activity, is known also to be stimulus specific. So there are neurons that will fire persistently at this angle, for example, in the visual field. There are other neurons that might fire persistently if the visual cue was presented at this angle, for example. So persistent activity is this delay, is this persistent firing in the absence of stimulation. Regarding long-term memory, the cellular correlate of long-term memory is thought to be long-term potentiation. Long-term potentiation was first theorized by Donald Head, and was found experimentally in the 70s in the brain slice. For example, if we have two cells and we give a specific stimulation on cell A, we get a specific synaptic response from cell B. However, if we give a strong stimulus, like a tetanic stimulation, which is 100 hertz for a few seconds, then following that tetanic stimulation, if we again stimulate cell A with a low stimulation as we did before, then we get a potentiated response, this red trace. And this potentiated response can stay potentiated for an hour, many hours, or even days. And this is LTP, and it's thought to underlie the storage, the long-term memory storage in the brain. Both of these processes, persistent activity and LTP, are underlined by the NMDA. It's a voltage-gated ion channel that activates with glutamate, so it's a glutamate receptor. When the channel opens, sodium, potassium, and calcium ions go through the channel, and it has a specific feature which is called magnesium block. So there is a magnesium ion that blocks the channel, and only when this magnesium ion is removed, which is caused, it is removed because of depolarization, so only when the neuron is already active, this receptor will function. And because of this function, it's thought to underlie LTP as well as persistent activity. So now I will present to you some data for both persistent activity and postdoc studies and long-term potentiation that we're currently doing in the lab. So as I said, the NMDA receptor is involved in persistent activity. The key feature of the NMDA receptor kinase that is involved in persistent activity is the delayed inactivation of the NMDA receptor. So this delayed parent that occurs here can support the emergence of persistent activity even in neural models. So a neural model with this type of conductance included into the model can persistently fire. Recently, it was also validated in vivo that if we block the NMDA receptor with the drug MK-801, we block this delayed period activity in monkeys. An intrinsic mechanism, so we have an ion channel, and this ion channel underlies the delayed after depolarization, as it is known. I will show you immediately what this is. And this delayed after depolarization is supported by this calcium activated non-selective cat ion pair. The identity of the channel has been hypothesized, but it is not specifically known. So, in order to study the delayed after depolarization in my PhD studies, I did pastoral recordings from pyramidal neurons in the prefrontal cortex. And in order to be able to see this DADP, we have to do two things. One is to use a drug that activates the metabotropic glutamate receptors. And another is to give stimulation to produce action potentials. So only when we activate metabotropic glutamate receptors and we can see this delayed after depolarization. This is a very small depolarization, 2-3 millivolts, but it has a very long decay. So this lasts for about 10 seconds. And this DADP can also be induced with synaptic stimulation of high frequency while blocking all the other glutamate receptors armed by NMDA. So this is a phenomenon, it's not just a pharmacological phenomenon, but it's also a synaptic phenomenon. This DADP allows the neuron to fire persistently even in a brain slice where we have blocked all synaptic communication. Just by depolarizing the neuron a little bit. And this seems reminiscent of the delayed period activity seen in vivo. And this is the parent that underlies the DADP, which has exactly similar amplitude and decay character. Now, when I went to Jota's lab to do neuronal modeling, I wanted to see whether using the DADP mechanism we can produce persistent activity in neural models. So what we did is was to construct a PFC pyramidal, layer 5 pyramidal neuron, which had very similar characteristics, electrophysiological characteristics with the experiment, and also simulate this DADP, so that the neural model had very similar DADP characteristics with the experiment. Using the DADP would induce persistent activity in the neural model, even in a single neural model. And we found that the properties of the neuronal response during the cue could predict the emergence of persistent activity in the neural node. So now in the lab, we study the long-term potentiation. And we do this by doing field recordings in the brain slice. So we cut brain slices, keep them in artificial cerebrospinal fluid, and put two electrodes on the slice, a stimulating electrode that provides current in order to stimulate the circuit, and the recording electrode that will record the synaptic responses. This is the synaptic response that we get. So this red part here is the stimulation artifact. The blue part is what is called a fiber volley and represents the stimulation of the axons. And the response, the synaptic response, is this curve. And we know that this is a synaptic response underlined by AMPA receptors. So we wanted to see if we can induce LTP in the prefrontal cortex. LTP is known to be. However, in the cortex, it is not so easy, and it's not always able to induce LTP. So what we did was measure EPSPs and give a stimulation, a tetanic stimulation, three times for 1 second. And in this in this situation where we record and stimulate in layer 2 of the prefrontal cortex, we could induce long-term potentiation that lasted for about 50 minutes, as long as the experiment lasted. And it was 50% potentiation compared to the baseline response before the tetanic stimulation. This potentiation we found was that it was dependent on NMDA, because blocking NMDA receptor with 85 also blocked the synaptic potentiation. Now, in doing experiments in mice of different ages, we found striking differences of the degree of potentiation between the different ages. So we continued and did a very detailed study of different ages, postnatal day 30, 40, 60, and 120. And we found that we can get synaptic potentiation in most of the ages, but we get this low potentiation at age 40, which is compared to the adolescent period in mice. Now, we wanted to do whether this was a property of the prefrontal cortex or just the cortex in general, because we have this increased plasticity in several areas of the cortex, but usually much earlier. So in the barrel cortex, we did experiments, and we found at least, these are preliminary, we just started the age-dependent study, so we have two ages at the time, 35 and 40 days of age, and there is no, it doesn't seem that there is a decrease in synaptic potentiation during adolescence. Now, long-term potentiation is known to be underlined strongly by the presence of dendritic spines. Dendritic spines are protrusions from the dendritic tree and are known to be the site of synaptic contacts. So the more dendritic spines a neuron has, the easier it is to have LTP. There are three different types of dendritic spines: stubby, mushroom, and thin. The stubby spines are thought to be the immature spines. The mushroom type spines are thought to be the spines where the LTP takes place. And the thin spines are thought to underlie persistent activity. So doing again here a detailed age-dependent study, we'll find again ups and downs of the density of the dendritic spines. And I will focus your attention again on age 35, where there is an increased density of the dendritic spines. Age 40 to 50, where it is low density. Again, age 60, where there is an increased density again. And at age 90, the spine density decreases. Now, this is, in the literature, the spine density has been correlated with critical periods of development in the cortex. So in sensory cortex, it is thought that there is a spine overproduction leading to a peak in the spine density, which occurs usually at the second postnatal week. And then there is a synaptic pruning leading to a decrease in the density of dendritic spines. There has been some data that show that in the prefrontal cortex, this spine overproduction probably continues until later, so until age 35. And synaptic pruning takes place there. So our data agree with this theory. However, we did identify a second period of spine overproduction at age 60. And here, this is the graph to show you the striking similarity between the percentage of LTP and the density of the dendritic spines. So at the postnatal day 35, we have increased density and increased LTP. At ages 40 to 50, we have decreased LTP and decreased spine density. And at age 60, density is increased, LTP is increased. And then we have a downgrade of spine density, but LTP remains quite high. Now, what we wanted to do next was to see whether these underlying mechanisms also support behavioral differentiation. So we want to see behavior. We conducted behavioral tests in animals, in adolescent animals and in young adults, so the age group of 45 and age group of 60. So we did two tasks that are PFC dependent, the delayed alternation, the TMAs, and the recency object recognition, and two tasks that are not PFC dependent, but depend on the hippocampus and the perirhinal cortex. The delayed alternation task in the TMAs is a very classic task that studies working memory in mice. So in this task, the mouse is placed in the center arm, freely allowed to choose, for example, the right arm, then is placed again in the center arm and has to go to the left arm in order to get the reward. And then if it goes again to the center arm, he has to go to the right arm to get the reward. So he has to learn to alternate these two arms. So once the mouse learns to alternate the arms, then we start imposing delays between the trials of the first 5 seconds, 10, 15, 20. So once he learns to handle the 5 second delay, we add the 10 second delay, and so on. So what we find is that adolescent mice have require more trials in order to learn the to alternate these arms when there are delays present. So more trials require the mouse to learn correctly the task in the 5 seconds, to perform correctly at least, again at 10 seconds, 15, and 20 seconds. In addition, the overall performance of the mice, is of adolescent mice, is decreased, and also the adolescent mice make more sequential errors. And the sequential errors are the index of perseveration, which is common in adolescents. The other task that depends on the prefrontal cortex is the recency or the temporal order object recognition task. In this task, the mouse is allowed to explore a certain object. After 25 seconds, he's allowed to explore a different type of object. And then in the test phase, he's shown with one object from the first phase and another object from the second phase. And what he has to do in order to perform correctly is that he has to explore the object that he saw the least recent object. So because it's supposed to be the object that he remembers the less. So adult mice do this very well. So they explore the old familiar or the least recent object more times than the recent familiar object. However, adolescent mice are not able to discriminate between the least familiar and the old familiar and the recent one. And this is the discrimination index for this task. However, adolescent mice perform just fine in tasks that do not depend on the prefrontal cortex, such as the novel object recognition task and the object to place. So in this task, the mouse is supposed to explore more a novel object. In this task, the mouse is supposed to explore more the displaced object. So both adult and adolescent mice explore more the novel object and the displaced object. So in conclusion, we find both behavioral and cellular age-dependent changes. So the LTP in the adolescent mice is decreased compared to adults. The dendritic spines are also decreased. They have good discrimination in novel object recognition and object place recognition memory that do not depend on the prefrontal cortex, but they have poor discrimination in temporal order recognition memory or in work memory tasks. And they also have increased perseverance. So this is a very solid base in order to further study age-dependent development in the prefrontal cortex and also determine whether there may be critical periods for the development of cognitive functions. So our goals are to study the role of dopamine, which dopamine is a neurotransmitter that is very involved in mediating proper function of the prefrontal cortex, as well as the role of GABA. And this would be our final goal, to identify critical periods for different cognitive processes, for example, working memory or behavioral inhibition or other processes. So we're moving now into the second part of the talk, where I will show you data showing adaptations or changes in the prefrontal cortical function, either behaviorally or at the cellular level. Our pathologies are two different kinds. So one, we talk about decreased inhibition, meaning decreased GABAergic inhibition in the cortex. And at the end, I will talk to you about our effort to set up a schizophrenia animal model in order to be able to compare animals, animal models of decreased inhibition or neural models with the schizophrenia-like phenotypes. So GABAergic inhibition, I told you at the beginning that neurons in the cortex are pyramidal neurons and GABAergic neurons. So there is a very, there is a balance of excitation and inhibition that is very important for proper functioning of the cortex. So decreased GABAergic inhibition can tip that balance and make the cortex hyperexcitable, and that can result in cognitive disabilities. Several neuropsychiatric disorders are known to have decreased GABAergic inhibition, and these include epilepsy, autism, and schizophrenia. One of the questions that arise is whether the decreased GABAergic inhibition is that that causes the neuropsychiatric disorder, or is that a secondary effect of the disorder that depends on something else. So in order to study this, we use an animal model that has decreased number of interneurons in the cortex. And this animal model was developed in Donna Karavalios' lab. In this specific model, the RAP1 protein is deleted from NKX2.1 expressing interneurons in the cortex, and these interneuron progenitors. And the end result is that there are decreased number of interneurons in the cortex of PD 15 days of age, of mice that are 15 days of age, but also in adult mice. One key feature of these mice is that half of them die before they reach day 35 because of epileptic seizures. We wanted to study the adult mice that that survived past the day 35, and these mice do not exhibit spontaneous epileptic seizures. However, they are more sensitive to pilocarpine-induced seizures. Pilocarpine is a muscarinic receptor agonist that causes seizures, and the dose that causes the maximum stage seizures in animals is 200 milligrams per kilogram. However, in the knockout mice, this dose is decreased to 100 milligrams per kilogram, so they're more sensitive. And also, we find that the cortex is more sensitive to epileptiform activity. So if we remove the magnesium ions from the extracellular fluid, we see that it takes quite a long time for the wild-type cortex to exhibit some epileptiform activity. However, in the RAP1 knockout mice, this epileptiform activity emerges much earlier and is more pronounced. In addition, these mice have increased anxiety phenotype, and we saw this with the open field test in the elevated plus maze. So the open field test is an arena where the mouse is placed and allows to explore it. And if the mouse goes more to the walls of the open field, then he's supposed to have a greater anxiety phenotype. And this is a RAP1 knockout mouse, while this is a head wild-type mouse. And the ratio of the time that the mouse spends in the walls compared to the periphery gives us a thigmotaxis index, which is increased in the wild-type mice throughout the duration of the open field test. Also, using the elevated plus maze test, where the mouse is allowed to explore open arms that are elevated from the floor or closed arms, the ratio of the time that the mouse spends in closed compared to open arms is increased in the RAP1 knockout mice, indicating again increased anxiety. Now, anxiety is mediated or is controlled by the prefrontal cortex. So we went to the prefrontal cortex to see whether there is plasticity there, applying the same protocol for long-term potentiation that I described to you earlier. So again, in the control mice, we do see the emergence of LTP. However, the RAP1 knockout mice are not able to potentiate their synapses in the prefrontal cortex. This is underlined partially by a decrease that is not significant but has a tendency towards significance of the expression of NMDA receptor subunits, NR2A and NR2B, and also by a decrease in the density of mushroom-type spines, as well as a decrease in the length a number of dendrites. Now, the increase in LDP could underlie the increased anxiety phenotype, allowing the not allowing the prefrontal cortex to control subcortical structures. So these mice, which we found a comorbidity phenotype of epilepsy and anxiety, both behaviorally and at the cellular level. Now our focus towards this project in the future is to focus on younger mice. And this will give us an opportunity to study the development of electrophysiological properties of inner neurons in the first few postnatal weeks, an area that is very or almost nothing known about, especially for the prefrontal cortex. And in addition, to see how the absence of a RAC1 protein or the combination of the absence of RAC1 and RAC3 proteins could affect the surviving interneurons. This is in collaboration with Donna Karagoyeos and her student Katerina Kalamaki. And also, we are interested in studying transgenic mice that have a developmentally decreased inhibition, like number of GABAergic interneurons, but with a less severe phenotype, so that we don't see epileptic seizures or a decreased threshold for epileptic seizures. And we are starting such a collaboration with Miltod and Nassar in London, who has generated a mouse that has an absence of LHX6, another transcription factor, specifically from PV interneurons. Now, in addition, we want to see how decreased inhibition alters persistent activity properties. And we did this using a computational neural model network. This was a work that started while I was still in Yota Poirasi's lab. So this is a network model of 16 pyramidal neurons, neuron models, two parvalbumin neuron models, one calbinin and one calretinin neuron model. And well, first, we know that this network can exhibit persistent activity firing. And when we decrease the number of GABAergic synaptic inputs to pyramidal neurons, we find two things. One, there is an increased probability for induction of persistent activity. And two, after a certain point, there is no selectivity for changes in the biophysical mechanisms, the GABA B here, for example. So at this point of very severe decrease in inhibition, the model responds with persistent activity to any stimulus that is given. In addition, and the most important finding is that we see decreased or disruption of gamma rhythm oscillations. Now, we know that the cortex in general, and this is seen in vivo, oscillates in the gamma rhythm, so between 20 and 80 hertz. So we wanted to see whether our model also exhibited such a property. And we find that in the control model, we find two peaks in this spectral density diagram. We find two peaks at the 20 hertz and one at 40 hertz. And even a small decrease by 20% shows that a decrease of the 40 hertz peak and higher decreases also show a decrease of the 20 hertz peak. Now, this disruption and decrease in the spectral density is known to exist both in schizophrenia patients and in animal models of schizophrenia. So our next goal in the lab is to see whether we can compare or make comparative studies in order to understand more about schizophrenia, but also compare them to an animal model of schizophrenia or having schizophrenia-like phenotype. Now, schizophrenia is a complex disease. It has positive symptoms, negative symptoms, cognitive symptoms. The etiology is again very complex. It's both genetic and developmental. Although many years have been, this disease has been studied for many years, still there are many unknowns on the pathophysiology and, of course, treatment for schizophrenia. There are two measurements that are cross species, and we can take advantage of these measurements in order to develop schizophrenia animal models. And these two measurements is the histological adaptation, specifically decrease in the expression of parvargument, and also the decreased sensory motor gating, which is measured with a procedure known as pre-pulse inhibition. So, in order to model schizophrenia in animals, usually we model positive and cognitive symptoms. It is very hard to model negative symptoms. There are several animal models that are used, both with a genetic background. A very well-known genetic background animal model is a DISC1 mouse, and a developmental background. And the most well and the most accepted animal model is the MAM model, which includes an exposure of this compound, methylazoxymethanol acetate, on embryonic day 70. And just one injection of this compound renders the mice with a schizophrenia-like phenotype when they are adult. So this animal model is known to have decreased PV expression, for example, is known to have decreased sensory motor gating, several cognitive symptoms. Now, this animal model has been developed in rats. And our goal here in our lab is to develop this animal model in mice because it's much easier to use it in comparison or in combination with genetic background animal models. So for mice, because mice have a different developmental process during embryonic life, we use two injection days, one embryonic 16, and so we either inject animals on E16 or on E17. And our goal now is to validate this model in mice. So first we do some behavioral experiments in order to study this enhanced response to dopamine, or specifically for us to NMDA antagonist, and decrease sensory motor gating using a test of locomotor activity in response to MK801 and pre-pulse inhibition. So our data from the MK801 experiment show that mice, both E16 and E17 treated or exposed mice, do show increased locomotor activity compared to previous treated mice. E16 are a little bit more severe. And also these mice, they show decreased pre-pulse inhibition. Now, what is pre-pulse inhibition? The mouse is placed into a chamber. It's provided with different types of sounds. A strong sound, which we call pulse, which is very, very strong, 110 decibels, and allows the mouse to stutter, to jump, for example. Or sounds that include a pre-pulse followed by the pulse. The pre-pulse comes about 20 to 50 milliseconds before the pulse, so the mouse cannot actually differentiate the two sounds. But the ultimate result is that the mouse responds less with a decreased stutter response. So these are the PPS-treated mice. Their response to pulse and their response to pre-pulse plus pulse, pre-pulse and pulse. And this is the response of the MAM-exposed mice, the response to pulse and pre-pulse and pulse. So we show that these mice, they do have decreased pre-pulse inhibition, shown here with the PPI index. In addition, we conducted experiments to examine the histological adaptations in the PV expression, and indeed, both MAM17 and MAM16 exposed mice have decreased numbers of PV neurons, both in layer 2 and layer 5 in the prefrontal cortex. And so since our model seem to be validated, possibly with the E16 group having a more severe phenotype, our goal is to conduct experiments to study the cognitive functions in long-term memory, working memory, as well as several cellular adaptations in these mice. And our more future goal is to determine whether stress, and specifically the corticotropin releasing factor receptor, is involved in mediating some of these features of the schizophrenia-like phenotype in mammals. So both stress and the CRF in humans is known to mediate or precipitate maybe the emergence of schizophrenia. So we'd like to know how this is involved, and also whether we can have CRF antagonists maybe improve the symptoms of the cognitive deficits in these mice. So in general, our long-term goal is primarily to identify these critical periods for cognitive development and to see whether the information that we gather through this developmental study, we can use some of this information to develop more age-specific, for example, treatments for pathologists, and also to determine whether we can have cognitive treatments, for example, that affect physiological mechanisms, also help the pathological. So I would really like to thank all the people in the lab, primarily these two ladies, Xenia, who just received her PhD in the fall, and Clary, who is now a PhD student. Several undergraduate students that have done a lot of work. These are the current undergraduate students in the lab. But also, these students have contributed to data that I showed you today, and most of them are now in graduate programs abroad. Our findings so far have been from initially Marie Curie Fellowship, from the NASAR Foundation and the Enrico Foundation. I would really like to thank the support from several collaborators here in Crete, specifically Donna Caravoyes for having an excellent, being very supportive of me in several levels. Yanis Haralabopoulos and Achilles Ravanis, again, we have a very good collaboration, and we actually do have data that are ready to be, published, but I couldn't show you here. George Halepakis, who is not a the dean of the Department of Biology, was very supportive of me there when I arrived at the department there. Panagiota Poirazi, who we collaborated very well previously, and we now continue our collaboration. Katerina Hadzaki is involved in Clary's PhD thesis. We just started a collaboration with the Cleopas in Cyprus in an effort to study oligodendrocyte communication. And I'm also very thankful to Donald and Mickey from who have supported me in my PhD studies, but also continue to support me here. I would like to say a few things of where these experiments are done, because IMDb is highly involved. So all the electrophysiology experiments are done in this facility, which was funded by the, or initiated with the generous Leventis Foundation grant, and continued to be funded through my own grants, but also through a general support from Achilles Gravanis and his 3D neuroscaffolds grant. And also in the process of trying to get all this data, we have developed an animal behavioral facility at the Department of Biology, where we have several apparatuses, and we can perform several memory function tests and stress or emotional tests. And thank you for your attention. Whether the mouse is exploring an object or not. So it's not as easy to do everything automatically.
About this difference between the adolescent and the adult mice, why do they exist? I mean, do they confer any advantage evolutionarily?
I'm not sure about the evolutionary. So most of these developmental studies have been done in visual cortex, for example. So in the visual cortex, it is known that there is this very specific period where if you intervene environmentally, for example, if you close one eye, then you can make your visual cortex blind to that eye while your eye perfectly sees. It's probably, I'm not sure if it's an advantage evolutionary, but it's definitely the way of or at least the way I understand it is the way that the brain is developing. The brain is trying to quickly develop and then slowly adapt or adapt. Okay. So in this quickly developing period, then that period is prone to either to do something good or something bad. Mm-hmm. So for cognitive functions, I mean for visual or for visual cortex, that is usually a very young age. But for the cognitive functions, this is usually during adolescence or early adulthood. So one of the critical periods, for example, or likely to be critical period, could be this age 60, where the animal is in this young adult phase. And so he's best, you know, he's at his best capabilities for cognitive functions. So that could be a plasticity. Now in the adulthood, the decrease in plasticity during adulthood could reflect other changes. For example, we know that there is an increase in dopamine during adulthood. And that's why adolescents have this very increased risk-taking behavior. And dopamine will be very important for cognitive function in adults, but because it is so heavily released during adolescence, it could cause all these decreases in cognitive function. But this is very acute. Yes.
What happens to your results when you disrupt the intrinsic condition as opposed to somatic? The PV, for instance, inhibition?
You mean in the model?
Yeah.
Because in it's not very easy to do it in animals. We didn't see any major effects. I remember there was an effect on was the most sensitive measure of seeing something. And I don't think disrupting the dendritic inhibition did much. Disrupting the disinhibition, you mean, or the calbinding? The calbinding. Okay, so disrupting actually calbinding inhibition, I think, if I remember correctly, that it made, it increased the power spectrum of oscillations. But this was something that we did very fast. But I remember it was very interesting when I saw it, but I think it was an increase in the spectrum.
To which frequency?
Oh, mostly 20 hertz.
So what are the modern neurons made of and what is their lifespan? How good
what
is that? You talked somewhere about modern.
Modern neurons?
Yes.
So this is computational.
It's
not the...
Absolutely.
It's not wet lab. No. It's in the computer. So they have a forever life.
Thank you.